A day before the results of assembly polls in five states, the opposition bigwigs from over a dozen parties met today to discuss a possible grand alliance ahead of next year's general elections.
Starting from Rahul Gandhi to Mamata Banerjee to Sharad Pawar to Ghulam Nabi Azad, anyone and everyone from the opposition, the top voices from the opposition party, they all came together in the Parliament Annex A building to hold this particular meeting.
The meeting called by Andhra Pradesh Chief Minister Chandrababu Naidu was attended by Congress President Rahul Gandhi, Trinamool Congress Chief Mamata Banerjee, DMK Chief MK Stalin, among others.
There was consensus in the room that we have to stop the BJP's assault on our institutions, and there was a consensus that we are going to work together to defeat the BJP.
Meanwhile, the resignation of RBI Governor Urjit Patel has put BJP on the back foot. Also, former Chief Economic Advisor Arvind Subramanian, who resigned from his post on June this year, stating that the economy is heading for a slowdown.
My own view is that I think we have to brace ourselves for a slowdown for some time.
In the meantime, the Westminster Court in London pronounced its verdict and decided to have Vijay Mallya extradited from the UK. While Mallya has the ability to appeal to a higher court, this verdict is a huge win for the government. Will all of these developments impact the mood before the general elections of 2019? What is in store for our country? The debate begins now.
Well, what's in store for us in 2019? Joining me on the show, Bharat Kumar Rao, political analyst, Radhika Ramsesan, consulting editor with the Business Standard, Vinay Tiwari, consulting editor of the Times Network, Pacha Sen, senior journalist, and Rajeshwar Kumar, who's a political analyst. I welcome you all to the show. Our audience will note there are no politicians on this conversation, which means that the conversation will be polite and it will be interesting. Vinay, I'm going to start with you, if I may. We just listed out all of this information. Obviously, this is going to have an impact on the next couple of days.
It will. I mean, it will certainly have an impact on the parliament session for sure. The fact that Mr. Urjit Patel resigned on the eve of the session, I mean, tomorrow, of course, there will be obituary references, so not much will happen. But day after, when they actually start the sessions, obviously, it's going to be a stormy one. Remember, day after will also be the aftermath of the results that will come out tomorrow. So yes, in terms of the political discourse, the resignation couldn't have come at a worse time for the government. Personally, between you and me, I don't believe it was just a very normal resignation. I do suspect there's more to it. The way the resignation letter has been worded, it definitely suggests all was not well. And that the government did not take a lot of things kindly over the last couple of months or so. And very clearly, I mean, I don't want to speculate on it, but very clearly, there are certain things that the government obviously wanted the RBI to do, which was not happening,
which
obviously they believe is now even more relevant, with the exit poll suggesting not such a great picture for them.
But, and we will have, for our viewers' benefit, an entire conversation at 9 p.m. about the resignation of the RBI governor. But from a point of view of the elections that we're going into, how much of an impact do you think that will have?
Look, I mean, personally, if you ask me, something like a resignation of the RBI governor, I don't think impacts voting per se in India. These are academic issues, frankly, which only select urban elite perhaps understand. I don't think the areas where the elections really matter or where they make a decisive difference, I don't think they really even understand the ramifications of, say, something like three or four economic advisors having quit and now the RBI governor having quit as well. I don't think they quite understand that. But obviously, from a policy point of view and from a governance point of view, it's a very significant thing. And
could that message also trickle down, perhaps, that all is not well?
Definitely it will. And I think that message has been there for a while, that all was not well between the finance ministry and the technocrats who've been helping the government and the finance ministry to make the policy. Obviously, everything is not well because you've had a series of instances of people and high quality people now moving out of active advisory roles to the government. So clearly there is a pattern to it which cannot be ignored.
As a journalist, and we've seen a pattern now, Arvind Subramanian, we saw, Panagra leave some time ago from the Niti Aayog, there was a resignation as well. And all of these people then started to speak out after they left. Are you curious to know if Mr. Urjit Patel will make a statement in the next couple of weeks?
I'm very curious to know whether he'll speak or not. I mean, Mr. Raghuram Rajan, when he left, although his tenure had ended officially, so it wasn't exactly he resigned and went. But he did not speak openly. I mean, for a while, he at least kept quiet and did not talk much about it. So he was very dignified about it. I'm not sure if Urjit Patel will necessarily also talk. My sense is that he may keep quiet for a while.
For a while,
especially with a very intense election period and a political period coming up.
All right, so let's take this piece by piece. Mr. Bharat Kumar Rao joins us as well. Arvind Subramanian has made a statement just today, Mr. Rao, saying that we should brace for an economic slowdown. He said the agriculture industry is not doing well. The financial industry is extreme. The financial sector is very tight. And this is not good news. All of this information coming together at the same time, Mr. Rao, what sort of an impact do you think it will have on the elections and on the next 6 odd months for this country?
See, all the information, all the statements and predictions which are coming now, they are a bit frightening, not for any party A or party B or government A, government B, but it is frightening for the nation's economy. So I'm more worried about that. Having said this, let me also say that why these statements are coming at this particular point, at this particular time, there is definitely a design, perhaps to destabilize the government or to take political advantage of whatever is happening in the nation. So, but that is okay. That is all political game. I am not against that. But I am telling you that if this is the situation, it is very frightening for the nation. And instead of giving statements, all these economists, they should advise and guide the government and government officials about how we should go about, rather than giving public criticism.
But Mr. Sen, do you think it's possible that they attempted to advise and then when that failed, perhaps then came out to speak in public? Mr. Rao, sorry. All right, I'll take that question to Badshah Sen.
I'm not getting you.
Yes, sorry. I'll take the question to Badshah Sen, senior journalist who joins us out of New Delhi. Mr. Sen, here's my question to you. We've had now a series of important profiled economists leave the government and then speak out after. Do you think this is timed to the elections coming up to destabilize the government? Or do you think there's something far more worrying for us as a country?
To begin with, I take Raghuram Rajan and Urjit Patel far too seriously to assume that they did this to take advantage of elections. They are not going to stand for election. The last economist and the first and last economist who did head this country, Manmohan Singh, even he never used to do things like this. So I cannot in any way ascribe political motives to either Mr. Patel or his predecessor, Raghuram Rajan. What I do see is that there has been severe political pressure brought to bear more on Urjit Patel than Raghuram Rajan, whose term, as Vinay said, had ended. There was this concerted effort to, when we know that the government has failed to meet its final fiscal deficit targets, it was trying to extract money out of the Reserve Bank of India, out of their profits. That was something that Urjit Patel steadfastly protected because that was his job as the governor of the Reserve Bank. I add to that, they were trying to get him to loosen the purse strings for loans to so-called small industries. We don't know what these small industries are. This is a government which protested loud and wrong when against all the bank scams that they talked about and the loan melas. What was the BJP doing this time around? I don't blame Mr. Patel to resign. He resigned because of this. Nothing to do with the elections.
Well, I also want an opening statement from Radhika Ramsesan, consulting editor of the Business Standard. Mr. Ramsesan, do you believe that that all of this coming in together is leading our country right now into perhaps an economic slowdown that should be of graver concern than the politics around it?
Absolutely. I think Dr. Arvind Subramanian has made a statement to the effect that we are heading for an economic slowdown. And coming from the former chief economic advisor, I think his words need to be taken seriously, analyzed. I personally think it's too late for any sort of substantial or meaningful intervention in order to correct the economy, you know, especially the rural economy. Anyone who toured the countryside in the recent elections They have seen just how bad the situation is in the agricultural sector. And agriculture, as we all know, I mean, you don't need to be an economist. It's common sense. It's not rocket science. Is the prime pusher for the economy. I mean, the moment there is an agricultural slowdown and the purchasing power in the rural areas goes down, I mean, you know that the economy is headed for a bad time. And that is precisely what is happening. Now, what is the government's answer? I really do not know. More loan waiver, a higher MSP. There's no point in hiking the MSP because in state after state, in Rajasthan, for instance, farmers complained that their crops were not being picked up by the government, you know, except very selectively, say, groundnuts. I mean, they were only getting MSP for groundnuts. So this is a very distressing kind of situation.
Yes.
And I really don't know how the government is going to come to terms with it, honestly.
Well, Vinay, actually, the Prime Minister did announce a 59-minute loan for small businesses that, again, I think was one of the arguments that or the flashpoints between the RBI and the government. Effectively, like Badshah said, was saying, that's a loan mela. And could have led us into more trouble.
Absolutely, it could have. And I think the larger point is, look, my personal sense is there is a pattern in which you can see that the government is slightly uncomfortable with the idea of listening to expert view if it is at variance with the government's. There is an art of consensus building. There is an art of listening to expert advice which may be at variance to your political requirement or need. And a smart politician or a wise politician uses that disagreement to course correct his or her own actions.
Yes.
During Mr. Manmohan Singh's tenure too, the economic advisor sometimes had a different view. He was himself an economic expert and then would have ideally should have had that arrogance to say, oh, I know it all because I've been there and I've done that. Clearly, he was better at handling that. And I can see that there is now a pattern where the advisor technocrats, where they disagree with the government, is not taken very kindly. They kind of try and ram it through, and which has led to dissonance. That is one. The other thing is this whole issue of loans. Economies work on momentum. And you may give loans to small industries, you may give loans to large industries too. But ultimately, economy moves and survives only when the produce, whether it's a farmer's produce or an MSME's produce, is getting bought by the consumer and there is a circulation in the market. There is no circulation happening. A lot of the circulation that is happening is artificially created, or it's just a question of selective sectors doing all right. But as a whole, there are a lot of sectors that are under stress. Some of it is because of the lack of cash that happened because of demonetization, some because of GST in large parts of India. And all of that cumulatively has now put the government in a spot where they don't have enough cash to even carry out their social welfare schemes.
Rajeshwar Kumar, do you agree that this will perhaps, while a lot of Indians are not directly impacted, like Vinay said, by whether or not the governor stays or goes of the RBI, there will be an indirect sense of things not being right in the country?
I think government should take the constitutional institution in faith. जब ये गवर्नमेंट शुरू हुई थी मोदी जी की उस समय बहुत सारे टेक्नोक्रेट्स को इन्होंने विश्वास भी लिया था और अपने मंत्रिमंडल में भी शामिल किया था लाइक एक सीए को लाया था उन्होंने रेलवे मिनिस्टर बना करके सुरेश प्रभु जी को मनोहर पर्रिकर जी को लाया था तो एक मैसेज गया था समाज में सोसाइटी में पूरे इंडिया में कि कहीं ना कहीं ये टेक्नोक्रेट्स को फेथ में लेकर के सरकार चलेगी और मिनिमम गवर्नमेंट मैक्सिमम गवर्नेंस की बात हुई थी लेकिन अभी जो है अगर इस तरह की दिक्कतें आ रही हैं अभी जो बात चल रही थी कि लोन मेला की बात चल रही तो इसके दोनों एस्पेक्ट्स हो सकते हैं मोदी गवर्नमेंट जो है मुझे लग रही है कि थोड़ी सी परेशानी है कहीं ना कहीं खास करके इकोनॉमिक पॉलिसी को लेकर के और इसको लेकर के स्वयं गवर्नमेंट के अंदर भी और गवर्नमेंट के बाहर भी पार्टी के अंदर और बाहर भी कई तरह की चीज़ें आएंगी आपको देर सवेर कि कहीं ना कहीं लोग डिसएग्री हैं सरकार की इकोनॉमिक पॉलिसी से लेकिन ये कारण नहीं हो सकता है आज उर्जित पटेल को रिजाइन देने का क्योंकि ये अकाउंटेबिलिटी उनकी नहीं है अगर इकोनॉमिक स्लो डाउन हो रहा है तो ये टाइम पीरियड जो है इस समय में ये मैसेज देना कहीं ना कहीं इसका कोई पॉलिटिकल टच तो नहीं है ये सोचने वाली बात है
Well, that's really the question that came up, and we had several members of our panel believe that this is not the reason. Also, I must remind our viewers that there was a point in November where there was an RBI board meet. There were rumors all over the country that Urjit Patel is likely to resign at the end of that board meet, but he didn't. And we assumed that that happened because they found some sort of common ground. But obviously, that common ground didn't last very long, Vinay.
Yes, the government had come up with a committee who was supposed to give a recommendation which would have, you know, led to certain decisions. But I think something more has happened. I mean, I really do believe that post that board meeting, something else happened where the government was trying to push or nudge him. And look, any professional who's worked as an economist for 35, 40 years will come with a certain degree of knowledge and certain degree of, intellectual arrogance. I don't want to use the word arrogance because it's misunderstood. But yes, there is certainly a confidence that what I'm saying is perhaps relevant and you should listen to it.
Yes.
When that is completely disregarded, any professional would perhaps find it very claustrophobic to be in that environment.
Well, I did have some off-the-record conversations with former RBI governors who told me a couple of things. One is that obviously there's constant disagreement between what the finance minister wants and what the RBI governor wants, and this has been the history in the history of this country. This has happened, but it is the duty, this one particular governor said, it's the duty of the finance minister to convince the RBI governor of what he wants, because it is the RBI governor and his team that are best placed to make monetary decisions, and they have to be convinced. If you can't convince the RBI governor, then you're not, your ideas or your decisions are not strong enough. But I just want to take this conversation one step further, and I want to introduce other pieces of information that came out today. The second piece of information, obviously the big one, and that was the Vijay Mallya verdict. If we just move over to that, we'll see that the Vijay Mallya verdict, and this is a case that's being heard in the Westminster Court of London for several months. I also want to remind you, this happened at a time when the CBI perhaps has seen its worst period in history, and it was the CBI that was arguing that case for India. And for the CBI to have received a positive verdict from this case, where the Westminster Court at least has decided that Vijay Mallya must be extradited. Vinay, this is a positive for the government. Is it as much of a positive as other people are seeing it as? Is it a positive enough to boost the image of this government as somebody that is fighting corruption and willing to bring people to the book?
The only point, Faye, where I have a slight disagreement with some of the other channels where they are hailing it as a victory for India, this is a round one victory. This is not the last round.
Okay.
There will be plenty more rounds because this is just the lower court verdict.
Okay.
It's a long way off before Vijay Mallya will physically be seen landing at the Delhi airport and being handcuffed away or taken away by CBI. That's some time away. Having said that, it definitely helps the BJP in its narratives, because something very peculiar is happening with the way BJP has contested these elections. If you would have followed Mr. Narendra Modi's speeches everywhere, there are three fulcrums around which all his speeches were revolving.
Okay.
One was the corruption, and by corruption he would extend it to the Gandhi family and the regime of the Congress, that was the corrupt regime for 60 years and they were the symbols of corruption, and hence everything wrong in this country is
because
they've done so in a rather corrupt manner. The second was, of course, the undertone of polarization, although I must say this, that Mr. Modi himself hasn't been as vitriolic as some of his other lieutenants, primarily Yogi Adityanath, who's been their divisor, the divider in chief of the party, who's gone around saying things which perhaps Mr. Modi can't say himself. And third, they have gone to the extent of trying to make this into a presidential election. So these are the three fulcrums around which this has revolved. With something like Mallya's extradition now at least the lower court agreeing with that, it helps them in his discourse that I'm serious about tackling corruption. Mm-hmm. That's the narrative they want to build. That, listen, that's a 60-year-old party steeped in corruption. I'm here and I'm trying to fix corruption. Help me get another 5 years before I get all of them back.
Especially since a lot of the corruption in Vijay Mallya's case happened under the watch of the UPA government.
Yes.
So I'm cleaning up what that government, and it does take time is what is the... Yes, so for my panel, if you want to come in, just gesture and let me know. Bharat Kumar Rao, go ahead, please.
Listen, I think talking about this victory as a victory for CBI and BJP government, it will be too naive to believe that it is a victory. This is because just a lower court has given this verdict. Mallya can still appear in two more stages. He has to go to the Supreme Court. So there is, and Supreme Court has this court, Westminster Court, has given them time for 15 days. This means that Mallya will take at least 4 to 5 months before the final verdict comes. So there is no point in talking about the victory at this stage. This is just one step, and that is one small step towards extradition of Mallya. I do not see much, I don't read much in this verdict, because there's one more step and after that the Supreme Court stage, though anything can happen after that.
Radhika ji?
Yeah, my point is that, you know, Mallya is not some small fish. There was one extradition from UK and nobody even seems to remember the name of the person who was extradited. The point is that the opposition has been taunting the government again and again on Vijay Mallya, Choksi and Nirav Modi. So to even get one big fish back, I mean, it's not going to happen immediately. I completely agree with the panelists. But the BJP is going to use this little or this development to its advantage in its whole narrative against corruption. I mean, we, our credentials to fight corruption are the strongest in the country. And you can trust the BJP, of course, to foreground the Gandhis, as well as Lalu Prasad Yadav and a number of other regional satraps in the narrative, so that it looks like that the opposition, which is trying to come together into some kind of a whole, is this one stinking, corrupt morass, which is going to drag the country down. And here is the BJP in shining armor out to cleanse the system, especially Mr. Modi. I mean, that is the kind of persona he's been trying to project to build, about himself ever since he took over. So, so this is definitely of a piece with the narrative that the BJP wants to foster.
Well, including the extradition of Christian Michel, who was a UK national, very difficult to make that happen. The government made it happen. Yeah. So there's a combined sort of narrative that they can build on this. Bacha Sen, go ahead, please.
Well, actually, the one point which nobody's addressed is how did Vijay Mallya get away? How did he go? There were stories to the effect that he had 13-second conversations, maybe 16-minute conversations with a very important minister who hasn't been named in Parliament House before he did the bunk. And that, when he did the bunk, it was this government which was in power, no matter what kind of corruption he indulged in during the Congress UPA regime. How come these guys let them get away? Yes. And he apparently had long conversations and he then went with 54 suitcases. He escaped this country with 54 suitcases. That this government will have to answer when he's back.
Yes.
And perhaps he'll tell us
that,
the minister
was named. It was Mr. Arun Jaitley.
Yeah, actually, because he issued actually a clarification as well. I mean, he actually ended up issuing, he was forced to, in fact, to issue clarification, yes, saying that he tried talking to me in the corridor, in the lobby, yes, of the parliament. And the minute he started talking, I walked away because I realized this was a conversation that was not required. So,
yes,
he issued a clarification.
Yes, he did. Rajeshwar ji, kya aapko lagta hai ki Vijay Mallya ko leke aur unka ye aaj ka jo verdict leke, this is a positive move for the government?
Yeah, main to manta hoon ki ye government ke liye ek bahut hi sakaratmak initiative hoga, kyunki agar Vijay Mallya se conversation ki baat jo keh rahe the hamare saathi panel mein, तो कि विजय माल्या से जो कन्वर्सेशन की बात कर रहे थे 30 सेकंड की या 30 मिनट की, कितने देर की बातचीत हुई अरुण जेटली जी से, तो माल्या के जाने के लिए अगर जेटली जी जिम्मेवार हैं, तो अगर माल्या आ रहा है तो उसमें जेटली जी को क्रेडिट देने में क्या बुराई है? नंबर दो, कि अगर जुडिशियरी, अगर विजय माल्या को लाया जा रहा है और इसके लिए जुडिशियरी को सारा क्रेडिट दिया जा रहा है तो ठीक है, तो फिर उसके लिए उसके भागने के पीछे भी या उसके सारे इसके पीछे भी लॉजिक्स आप गवर्नमेंट को फिर मत दीजिए, या तो गवर्नमेंट को क्रेडिट मत दीजिए, नहीं देना है, गवर्नमेंट तो क्रेडिट लेगी इसके लिए। तो मैं समझता हूँ कि ये करप्शन के मुद्दे को लेकर के, खास करके अभी राहुल चौकसी और नीरव मोदी को लेकर के और विजय माल्या के संदर्भ में एक अच्छा इनिशिएटिव है, और गवर्नमेंट अगर इसको चाह रही है कि हाँ ठीक है, पॉजिटिवली कह रही है कि ये मेरे लिए क्रेडिट है, तो उससे हमें कोई आपत्ति नहीं होनी चाहिए, लेकिन इसका रिजल्ट और आगे आना चाहिए।
Yeah, I brought that up. It is, I mean, if you hire a chowkidar, we were told there was a certain chowkidar and he was going to protect the national interest, and then suddenly he falls asleep and this thief escapes. And then whether, I agree with Vinay Tiwari, there was a clarification. However, there is still no answer to the fact that this chap left with 54 suitcases. under the nose of this government and the chowkidar. And now, when he's been brought back, thanks to the adroit maneuvers of lawyers and the CBI and so on, the chowkidar gets the credit. But he must also get the blame, for God's sake. So I'm looking at it one way, and my fellow panelist is looking at it another way. I don't see any tremendous conflict in the two. I just want to know, how did Vijay Mallya get away? That is something we need to know. So when he comes back, the first thing that we should find out from him, how did you get away? How did you leave this country? That's exactly what I'd like to know.
Well, at least we've gotten to a point to say when he comes back, not if he comes back, but when you to respond to that?
No, I agree with Basha. I mean, of course, you need to know. That's important, not only if in his case, back. But only yes, even yes. in Nirav Modi's case and Choksi's case as well. Clearly, they were tipped off. Clearly, they knew that something was happening.
And in Nirav Modi's case, we now know that the Income Tax Department had a report on its table for 8 months.
And they didn't do anything.
Yes. They didn't sound off any of the agencies. They didn't tell the police. They didn't tell anybody. And there was obviously something going on there because it was a lot of money.
That's right. And I don't think I need to play devil's advocate for a government which has plenty of advocates of their own. But if I had to play devil's advocate, the only thing I would say is we sometimes underestimate the kind of nexus that exists between businessmen or other people and bureaucrats and officials as well. There is a deep-rooted information network between bureaucrats and officials and businessmen that exists. And sometimes even the politicians are not aware of what's happening. The bureaucrats are the smartest people. The smartest Indian is actually the bureaucrat here. They smell the success of the defeat faster than anybody else. And they also figure out which way the wind is blowing faster than anybody else. So it's quite possible some of it happened maybe because of bureaucratic collusion. I'm not saying necessarily only a politician was involved. But there is certainly a collusion of some sort.
Well, the other piece of information I now want to introduce is the various meetings that have been held by the opposition over the last 2 days since the exit polls came out, and we just run some of the footage of it. There was a meeting of the Mahagahtbandhan. There was a meeting called by Chandrababu Naidu, Mamata Banerjee, Arvind Kejriwal. These were all people involved in the meeting. They did address a press conference. We understand that Chandrababu Naidu actually made a presentation to the entire group listing out the reasons why they should work together and why they should be partners. Interestingly, from a body language point of view, if we look at the press conference that was addressed later, it was Rahul Gandhi standing in the front and a lot of very senior leaders standing behind him. People like H.T. Devagowda from Karnataka, you'll see in that visual, if we just run it full frame so our audience can take a closer look, you'll see a lot of very senior leaders standing behind him. Right behind him, in fact, is Mr. Sharad Pawar, there's Chandrababu Naidu, you can see Stalin from and Praful Patel as well behind him. We have Raja, Stalin and Farooq Abdullah, if I'm not mistaken, who's also there. So here are a couple of problems that the opposition is going to have to deal with. No clear leader, far too many prime ministerial hopefuls in that group. And if we look at, and we've accessed this presentation that apparently Mr. Chandrababu Naidu made to the group, it's fundamentally about keeping the BJP out, rather than a sort of combined idea with all of them. So they're an anti-BJP group and not a pro-something group. There's no one political ideology that they all share. Do you think they'll be able to overcome all of these problems?
Right, and because by instinct, we journalists are cynical in nature. So when you ran that full frame picture, there were three very cynical things that comes to my mind when I see that. Number one, while it is a group that has too many leaders, and one way of looking at it is there's no leader, you can see there are two or three people trying to project themselves as the leader. So when you have Rahul Gandhi literally positioning himself right at the lectern and Chandrababu Naidu next to him, and with Chandrababu Naidu very nicely ensuring that his presentation gets leaked to the media just before it is actually done, it tells you that he's also now, his hat is also in the ring.
Yes.
It's not just the North Indian politicians anymore. It is his hat in the ring as well to position himself as a compromise candidate should there be a disagreement between the North Indian warring lords, so to say. One other image from this visual that is on the screen right now is there is no Mayawati here and there is no Akhilesh Yadav here. Because they are playing their own game.
Yes.
They are obviously waiting because they also know that they have the advantage in numbers. If that Mahagathbandhan actually happens in UP, they will come back with a block that will perhaps prove decisive for any formation. And they obviously know that. And that's why you see them not standing here. And that will have as much an impact going forward as this group's ability to hold together.
So 21 parties were in this meeting altogether. But you're absolutely right. No Mayawati and no Akhilesh Yadav would mean that it's still not a full, complete...
It's not the 1971 kind of a Gathbandhan where everybody was against Indira Gandhi barring one or two parties. This is a slightly version 2 of that. Going forward, can it happen or not? I mean, of course, in the assembly elections, you saw the BSP and the Congress couldn't get along and they couldn't do a seat-sharing agreement at all. Who knows? Tomorrow we might find out that is what proved costly for them in Chhattisgarh.
Yes.
Most people agree that if they had tied up in Chhattisgarh with BSP, maybe the result would have been very, very different. But having said that, so there are many ways you can look at this group that is on the screen right now. Hmm. The new jostling, the emergence of Chandrababu Naidu, who's clearly positioning himself as an option.
Yes.
And definitely the
and we've heard journalists in Hyderabad tell us that he's a clear, you know, prime ministerial candidate. Radhikaji, do you agree that, and I'm going to keep the visual on because I know my viewers would want to take a closer look at it. We'll put Radhikaji in the box. Radhikaji, do you agree that, there are too many hopefuls in this group, but Chandrababu Naidu seems to be positioning himself as one such clear prime ministerial candidate?
Well, Babu has got his place under the sun after a long, long, long time. But I think he has miles and miles to go before he can even hope to be considered as a PM candidate. I think he got his chance in when the United Front was formed, and then he chose to take a back seat, and eventually he went and aligned himself later with the BJP. So Chandrababu Naidu is certainly not the most trustworthy of allies. Having said that, he certainly cast his lot with the Congress right now. But talking about prime ministerial hopefuls in this frame, I certainly don't see Sharad Yadav as one. Mm. There is Mr. H.D. Devegowda sort of peeping from behind. I think if I'm right, it is Mr. H.D. Devegowda.
Yes.
Stalin is certainly not. There is Ghulam Nabi Azad. So I don't really see a prime ministerial hopeful, barring, of course, Rahul Gandhi, if he chooses to unveil his ambitions at some point. But what I gather from talking to different opposition leaders is that they are not going to get into this tricky issue of, you know, zeroing in on a PM candidate, declaring a PM candidate, because they think the best way for this coalition to go forward right now is to fight the BJP as a cohesive opposition on issues without getting tangled with personalities. But as Vinay Tiwari rightly pointed out, the absence of Mulayam Singh and Mayawati is a big, big drawback. There was Ajit Singh, but Ajit Singh just counts for, a very small part of Western UP. I mean, he carries his weight all right, but it's very limited. So what is what is Akhilesh Yadav, what are his plans? What are Mayawati's plans? I mean, unless they come out and sort of declare their agenda, this kind of an opposition unity, to me, makes very little sense. Because let's not forget, there are 80 seats in Uttar Pradesh, of which the BJP has 73. So it's a long haul for the opposition.
Well,
there is a certain spring in the Congress's step, no doubt, because I think they are anticipating a fairly positive outcome tomorrow. But I still, Faye, I don't think that's good enough to... give them optimism, which is kind of disproportionate to the strength of the opposition.
Well, you know, it's easy to sit around the table now, but will they be able to agree on seat sharing in every single state that these 21 parties are from? And that's going to be the big one. We've already seen that the Congress has had trouble in arriving at these agreements in state elections. So the national election will be very complicated. Bharat Kumar Rao, go ahead, please.
Yeah, I was listening to the debate and also seeing the picture of the press conference. I was really amused. There was Rahul Gandhi, who is standing in the middle, flanked by some other leaders. And there are many, at least six, half a dozen people, leaders of the region. I saw they were trying to raise their head from behind. It means there are at least half a dozen, if not more, at least half a dozen PM Minister candidate in that Mahagahtbandhan. And as days pass, the number of those candidates will grow. And that will be fatal for the Mahagathbandhan. If you remember, some years ago, actually this is every 5 years, this show happens of opposition Mahagathbandhan. Till these days, it used to be against Congress. Now it is against BJP. That is the only difference. As the selection of candidates will come, that question will arise, they will start falling apart in any case. And as you said, Mulayam Singh is absent, Akhilesh is absent, and Mayawati is absent. So still, it is a picture incomplete. That
yes.
If the picture is incomplete, it is very, very difficult to believe that this is really Mahagathbandhan. Hmm. If it is Mahagathbandhan, there are at least 3-4 other big parties should have been party to this. They have not. Therefore, it will be a very, very, very poor show at the end of the day, believe me.
And UP is the largest state that will offer you far more seats
before the election or after the election.
Yes, and UP is the largest state that offers more seats than any other. But Vinay, if you'll allow me, or forgive my panel will forgive me for bringing the Instagram generation for a second, and we put that visual of the press conference back up. This was my feeling as a young person looking at this visual. The people attempting to poke their heads above the crowd and be noticed are very senior politicians. It does seem disrespectful in the manner in which this crowd has gathered. There could have been a better way perhaps to treat your senior politicians or your senior, let's say, Gathbandhan members, than to have them sort of, you know, hold over each other's shoulder. This Devagowda, this Sharad Pawar, these are very senior people. Do you think that this sends a sort of not a very good message?
So can I just say something which will perhaps demolish this, slight, I mean, I'm not saying Instagram-led, but certainly a younger idealism that you have. Look, politics is not about sending messages or being respectful.
Okay.
You have in Akhilesh Yadav a man who threw out his own father from his own party.
True.
Okay, he didn't spare him because politically he realized that his continuance in the Samajwadi party was not beneficial. I mean, so he pretty much now governs the party. And Mulayam Singh has been reduced to nobody in his own party, somebody who actually built it from scratch. So politics isn't about that at all. I don't think politics is about being respectful at all. Having said that, politics is certainly about showing magnanimity when the brass tacks are being discussed, and which is where I still have my slight doubts over Congress's capability, and by Congress I mean implication Rahul Gandhi's capability of being magnanimous.
Yes.
If you have this self-appointed role of being the leader of the opposition combined without really having the numbers to show for it, you will run into issues in certain states, because in this group there are, as we can say in Hindi, isme bahut share hain aur apne apne states ke sab share hain. They are not going to yield so easily to you just because you have assumed the role of a leader.
Yes.
So that is where the key will be. And in fact, it's not so much about the primary candidate at all. It's really about seat sharing.
Yes.
If you can come up with a tactical seat sharing which is done smartly, and I'm saying smartly because when you do seat sharing, you have to kill aspirations of your own party members in many areas.
Mm-hmm.
That's not easy to handle. Only a mature leader can do that. That is the only way you will be able to take on a machinery like the BJP.
So I suppose the question we should ask now, Badshah, and I'm going to ask you this question. So it's not really, whether or not Rahul Gandhi should or should not be Prime Minister is a question for a later day. But does he have the political maturity to be able to handle these tough decisions and to be able to actually reach a consensus among all of these 21 parties?
First of all, I don't think that was the objective of the meeting today.
Okay.
Although Chandrababu Naidu has in the recent past said that they should coalesce under the leadership of the Congress. He has said it more than once because he is merely a leader of one state. The Congress used to be in many states and depends. The big difference will be if the Congress wins 3 out of the states, assembly elections, 3 out of the 5, which I'm not saying they will, but the poll of polls has said that they've got a slender margin in Madhya Pradesh, as also Chhattisgarh, and a solid majority in Rajasthan. So if the Congress does have such a chunk of the Hindi belt, the whole game might change. It is very possible that Akhilesh Yadav and Mayawati might change their mind. There are people who are changing their minds about the NDA because now they see the NDA might well be on the decline. Already you've got the Kushwaha factor in Bihar. He's quit the NDA. It's going to be a bit of a problem for the BJP that Chandrababu Naidu quit the NDA and has gone over this side. So there's a lot of churning going on. It's not just that these are 21 guys in search of a leader. There is one leader who will suddenly be in search of followers because we don't know what's going to happen to the NDA at the end of this.
Well, let me just put one last point before this panel in the time that we have left, and that has to do with the rural economy or the farm, the farmland crisis that we have right now. Obviously, unfortunately, the government might be forced at this point to acknowledge that farmers mean votes and they have to do something about it. There isn't enough time, though, to make any sort of real impact. Is this something you think is going to be addressed in the winter session or in the budget session? Is there something you think the BJP will attempt to do before the next election?
They will certainly do that, but I sincerely believe it's too late for them to do that. It's very surprising. I'm astounded, in fact, that if you see from 2014, 26 May, when they took oath, the first 3 years, this government made absolutely no mention of farmers at all. It was largely about the industry, it was about economy, it was Make in India, it was
smart cities,
it was Digital India, it was all of those. The farmer was never really part of discussion at all. And if you notice, the current government sensed something is wrong over the last 1 year. Suddenly, if you notice, the Prime Minister went around speaking about implementation of the Swaminathan Commission report, he went around speaking about the MSP was revised. All of this realization has happened
Fasal
in the
Bima
last
Yojana
seven,
and things
exactly,
like that.
The Fasal Bima Yojana. So all of this has happened in the last 7-8 months, yes, or maybe a year. So the realization has come a little late. And remember, farms and farm crises are cyclical in nature. So people who've already suffered and damaged, the impact of this damage will last another 6 months. That is part A. Part B, one other thing. I think the government failed to realize at the start that Indian agriculture sector has gone through a structural change. Between 2004 and 2014, when UPA was ruling, the biggest problem for farmers was lack of diesel, lack of fuel, and lack of electricity. So it was impacting their capability to produce. That problem got sorted to a large extent in the last 4 years. Undeniably, there has been an improvement on that. There has been improvement in power, and there has been an improvement in the fuel supply as well. But the new problem as a result of that has been the farmers' ability to market their produce, which is where all the promise of the APMC being dismantled and all that, which has not happened, is started impact. So now you have farmers who have produced a lot and they are actually a victim of overproduce, but they're simply not being able to sell at the price that they should. And this government has completely failed to realize that, with the result that now you're in a trap where you will not be able to come out of it in the next 6 months at least.
Yes.
At least till the voting will happen, it's very difficult to come out of that.
Radhikaji, what are you expecting from the government in the next 3 or 4 months as far as the farm sector is concerned?
Very little. Two quick points. One is the budget session is a small window for the government to make some policy announcements or whatever. But I don't see that happening, simply because for Mr. Modi and for Mr. Jaitley, GST and demonetization. Demonetization for Mr. Modi and GST for Mr. Jaitley. They signpost the economic policies of this government, and there is no way that they are going to acknowledge that both these have an underbelly of failure. Not just an underbelly, they've been pretty overt kind of failures, as was evident in the recent in the pre-election trends. So unless they acknowledge that demonetization has failed partially or largely, GST has failed again partially or largely, there is very little scope for bringing correctives.
Well, I'm going to give the last word to Bharat Kumar Rao. Bharat Kumar Rao, at the end of the day, the farmers will add up to votes, and in large numbers, I suppose. This is something we're going to witness come tomorrow morning when the election results of the 5 states come in. These are, these are states that are agriculture heavy. Do you believe that they, in the war room of the BJP, there will be strategy towards the farm sector?
Better they do some strategy, though it is now too late for having strategy done. They already missed the bus. Let me first admit, and the government should admit, for that they have failed to address farmers' issues. Rather, in first 3 years, we never thought that there is an issue for farmers. Because everybody was talking about industry, about middle class, the urban class, and nothing about the rural class. When they talk about rural class, they were talking about rural skill development, but nothing about farming. Mm-hmm. In Maharashtra, we saw from 2 years, farmers are up in arms. and nobody took cognition of them in the center. What best they thought that they will, if the loan waivers are given, the farmers would be happy. But that was not addressing the root cause of the issue. And now, if at all government is serious about farmers, at least they should give some white paper in which they should spell out what they have done and what they would like to do if they are returned, if they are elected again. But in this next 3-4 months, nothing can be done, because now we'll be facing summer, and in summer the farmers' issues will be worsened than resolved. So therefore, because the, by then elections will be over. Election would be over by April, March or April. Then it will be, the country will be engulfed with huge summer. There will be water scarcity, there will be fodder problem, the cattle head would be a problem. So I think government is heading for a worse situation than they have ever imagined.
Well, before I wrap up, a very quick question to you. We did talk about the fact that Startup India, Skill India, Housing for All by 2022, Smart Cities, Make in India, massive events that were held, MOUs were signed, announcements were made. There hasn't been too much mention of that for the last 1 year. It's almost as if there's been a sort of sense of amnesia as far as these projects are concerned. No, is that going to hurt as well?
Well, what is going to hurt is their inability, their non-recognition of the fact that farmers were undergoing a bit of an issue and that they should have started fixing it way in advance. The issues of agriculture take time to fix. They are very cyclical in nature. You can't fix it just by announcing a scheme. So what has certainly hurt is the delay. I think this was a calculated strategic shift where they stopped talking about it completely, because they realize that the more you talk about it, the more the perception of this government being pro, so-called pro-rich, which the Congress is using as a talking point as well, that they're always talking about industry, they're always talking, and that sends a message of being pro-rich.
Suit Boot Ki Sarkar is something the Congress took advantage of.
Absolutely. And if you see the post-Suit Boot Ki Jibe, which kind of stuck with people post-Gujarat, they revised their style and they stopped talking about it completely.
All right, we've run out of time, but fundamentally it brings us to what happens tomorrow morning. Now, tomorrow morning, we will have election results beginning to trick in 8 a.m. onwards from 5 different states, states that will matter a great deal, not just to send an indication to the BJP and to the opposition of where things stand for 2019, but also to the rest of us. Will the farmers tilt one or two of those, of those elections? What will that actually mean? And what will the strategy be for all of these parties, opposition and otherwise, going into 2019? So we'll be covering the elections here on Mirror Now in the same sort of calm and, stoic fashion. So we welcome you to join us right through the day. And we will be live on Facebook as well for updates on the state election starting tomorrow morning. Thanks for watching.